Let's bring in our panel, political scientist Dr Jennifer Curtin from Auckland University, Max Harris, Rhodes Scholar and author of The New Zealand Project, and Sir Don McKinnon, former Deputy Prime Minister and Foreign Minister, a former Commonwealth Secretary General too. Thank you all very much for being with me this morning. Jennifer, I'll start off with you. We heard the Prime Minister there talking about not being superwoman, but that she has an obligation to New Zealand as well. What did you take from that part of the interview?
Oh, I think she's got a handle on this. It seems it's business as usual, but adding the motherhood aspect in, she's following cabinet manual procedure in terms of how to hand over the leadership. And I think the big thing about, while everybody might be interested in what's going to happen with the birth of this baby, it's really important that the media and others don't fetishise this, that it's a normal part of being a parent in politics, and that we stay focused on what's happening in politics rather than what's happening in motherhood land.
It is rare though, Max, isn't it? It's only the second time in history that a leader has given birth while in power.
Yeah, it's rare, but I think we saw in that interview a lot of the qualities that have made New Zealanders at ease with Jacinda Ardern as Prime Minister. She had a nice mix of humour and directness and honesty. I think one interesting thing about the pregnancy will be Clark Gayford being a stay-at-home dad, which I think will be a really important role model for young men. I think she's made at least me feel comfortable that things will be under control.
And so, Don, you've had been a parent in power. What can she expect? What's it like? A lot of balls juggling in the air?
Well, yeah, different probably being an absent father, but yes, suddenly there are a whole lot of challenges that you do want to respond to as a mother, which will come into conflict from time to time, but I think she has a remarkable ability just to adapt as things change and go forward.
Jennifer, you talked about that handing over of the political process. She said she has no concerns whatsoever with Winston Peters coming in. Can you talk us through that process? What's going to happen?
Well, I mean, it's actually pretty normal, and we've seen it before, because Jim Anderton was Deputy Prime Minister of a different party when Helen Clark's government was first elected in 1999. And so we know that it's not unusual in an MMP system to see a member of a different party become acting Prime Minister. And the Cabinet Manual is really clear on this. People want to be wonks about this. They can go to Section 2 or they can go to Section 6. So there isn't really anything extra we need to see happen.
There will be a few of us who have done that.
Yeah, so I think really what's where the unknown is more less around her and more around Winston Peters and the length of time that he will be acting Prime Minister, which is what will be unusual.
And you've worked closely with Winston Peters. Do you have any concerns? How is he going to handle all of this?
Oh, extraordinarily well. No one's got more experience in Parliament than he has, going back 30 or 40 years. He's seen it all, he's known it all, he's been acting Prime Minister before, he's capable of being very relaxed about it. He'll do fine.
Is it just the media who are concerned, and does anyone really care about that? Probably not.
Look, he's got a huge machine behind him in terms of the Prime Minister's department, so he doesn't need to wait for anything. Look, the test of any leader is how do they handle shock, unpredictability, the unexpected. That's when a leader really emerges.
What's your take on that? I mean, sitting back and watching, do you feel pretty comfortable with Winston Peters being in charge for that six-week period?
I think, as Sir Don said, he's had the experience before. I think he's got a good overview of government. I don't have major qualms. And of course, government is a team effort as well. They've shown that, as Jacinda Ardern said, they're a true MMP government, and they've managed to hold that team together pretty well, I think, so far. So, yeah, no specific worries there from me. Yeah.
One thing I wanted to talk to you specifically about from the interview, you've written in your book about the values, and we should bring more values back into New Zealand politics. Yeah. The Prime Minister there was talked about kindness and whether that's something that she's brought in to the New Zealand Parliament. Is this something we should care about? Because for most of us, kindness isn't at the top of the list when we think about what we want from our politicians.
I think it is really important. I think the government and the Prime Minister can set the tone for how a country runs. And I think Jacinda Ardern's done that really well so far. And I think they've made a few decisions so far that I think have been really values-driven, say, around not building Waikerea prison or the end to offshore drilling of oil and gas. I think there are a lot of challenges still ahead. But I think New Zealanders do think that values matter, and they want to see politicians reflect the best of our values.
What's your take? Kindness, is it important?
I think it is important. I think in my time I saw the move towards sound bites, and all parliamentarians then spent time and time developing the right sound bite, because that's all the media wanted. The kind sort of elements of speeches in the House just disappeared completely.
But in the debating chamber, there's not kindness going on, and do we even want that?
I think you require better manners within the debating chamber, which is possible, but again, I come back, people will get attention in the debating chamber by saying something extraordinary, something outlandish, and that's what they tend to strive towards.
Is the media the problem, do you think, in that talking about this kindness and this value coming into politics?
Well, I think in the House people would probably enjoy seeing a little more civility, perhaps, rather than kindness. But I do think that we are likely to see different values coming through different policies. So, for example, the Treasury is now working on a well-being framework to inform economic measuring economic success. And that's a shift. That's a shift from focusing just on hard measures like GDP and moving to measures that encompass a better understanding or a more inclusive understanding of what makes people's lives better. And we might be able to extrapolate and say that's, you know, a different way of valuing moving that forward into actual policy changes.
One of the things she talked about there was one of Corinne's first questions was being a transformative government. She said, we will be. What did you take from that?
Oh, a determination to do just that. She really does want to show more than just pictures of a gender change, age change, the lot. This is a whole generational change, and she's firmly wanting to put that to the centre of New Zealand. And so far, she's probably been reasonably successful.
What did you make of that answer, Jennifer, saying we will be, I guess, picking up on that language of let's do this during the election campaign?
Well, I think there's a pragmatic element to it, which is she wants to unroll the transformation over the next 3 years so that they're ready to run and win again in 2020. I also just, you know, from looking at how transformation as a term is used in the business community and the corporate world, this is a term that gets bandied about quite a lot, and it's not always clear what the measurements are that sit behind it. So, you know, to expect transformation in just over 100 days is probably unrealistic from anybody's point of view.